Sup guys, I'm Voltaine Black, and welcome to part 2 of my favorite characters. Again, I'm going to put a disclaimer in this video. It does contain spoilers for the Heroes of Olympus series, and so if you haven't read that yet and want to read it, I suggest you click off this video. But today, I'm going to be discussing one of my top favorite characters of all time, who comes from this series, Leo Valdez. Now, at the beginning of the series, Leo is very much a character who at first glance actually appears to be very much like Keith. He's very jovial, funny, and a goofball. But deep down, he also holds darkness, insecurities, and a lot of regrets. Leo Valdez also has pyrokinetic abilities due to being the son of the Greek god Hephaestus, and he is also a fantastic mechanic. Leo appears in the very first book of the series, The Lost Hero. We learn that at the age of 8, his mother died, and Gaia, the evil earth goddess, intending to try to break his spirit, appeared and scared the young Leo. He used his fire abilities to try to stop Gaia, but ended up burning down the entire workshop that he and his mother were working in, and killing his mom. He was rejected by his family after this. After growing up in numerous foster homes, he eventually gets found by Camp Half-Blood, a camp full of children of the gods just like him, who bring him to their camp and train him and keep him safe. There, he learns actually that his pyrokinetic abilities are extremely dangerous and there's a huge stigma against them, so he actually keeps them hidden. While at Camp Half-Blood, he befriends Jason, the son of Zeus, and Piper, the daughter of Aphrodite, and he eventually goes on a quest with them to defeat the giant enchiladas, save Piper's dad, and get Jason's memory back, but most importantly, to free Hera, the queen of the gods, who was captured by these evil giants, the sons of Gaia. The condition for him joining the quest, though, was that he find somehow a means of transportation. Leo, though, already had a plan for this, and he used his mechanical know-how and his connections to machines to befriend Festus, an animatronic dragon who lives in the woods. He then fixed the dragon up and gave it wings after he found Bunker 9, an abandoned workshop from previous wars at Camp Half-Blood. Throughout this quest, he uses his mechanical knowledge to tinker away many of the group's problems, and when they crash into a warehouse, Jason and Piper are captured by Cyclopses, he is forced to reveal his pyrokinetic powers to save them. He's scared that he's going to be judged by Piper and Jason, but turns out they become his first real friends, his first friends to actually accept him for who he is. They complete the quest, and Hera reveals that Percy Jackson, the hero of the first series, who had previously been missing in this series, was actually at Camp Half-Blood's Roman counterpart, Camp Jupiter. Leo then prepares a ship, the Argo II, to fly there and join the Romans in order to combine their efforts on a quest to defeat Gaia, as was foretold by the Prophecy of the Seven. Leo does not appear in The Son of Neptune, except in very rare visions, because the book actually takes place at Camp Jupiter and with characters from there on their own quest. He does appear in all subsequent books, though. In The Mark of Athena, Leo joins Piper, Jason, Annabeth, Percy, Hazel, and Frank, those chosen by the Prophecy of the Seven, to go to Greece and defeat Gaia at her ancient roots. Their first challenge arises when Leo encounters Nemesis, the goddess of revenge. She tells him he will always be the seventh wheel and never fit in with the rest of the crew, never be accepted. Nemesis offers to help take down the proud and mighty, namely Gaia. She gives Leo a fortune cookie and tells him that he'll open it when he needs it most. Leo and Hazel then meet Echo and have by far Leo's best scene. He has to face Narcissus to steal his mirror. So in doing so, he has to distract Narcissus by strutting about proclaiming his superior coolness. He draws tattoos on himself, slicks his hair back, puts on welding goggles like sunglasses, and starts flirting with the nymphs. I normally reserve quotes from characters till the end of the video, but this scene is just too good not to quote now. His first quote comes when Narcissus asks, "Who are you?" He replies, "I'm the supersized Mishizzle man. I'm Leo Valdez, bad boy supreme, and the ladies love a bad boy." Narcissus then goes on to call him scrawny and a pathetic weakling. But Leo responds, "Scrawny? Scrawny is the new sizzling hot, and I've got the scrawny." Oh, it's so good. There are more quotes coming up at the end, so you have that to look forward to. He is a great character. Throughout most of the book, Leo's piloting the ship, and he goes through many different adversaries, storm gods, earth giants, blah de blah de blah, who are trying to kill him, the usual. We don't really have time to go into all of that right now, but just note that this is an actual quest. There are other side things going on. It's important to note that Leo doesn't lose heart, and he perseveres through all of these trials. So later in the story, Leo and Hazel do share a vision of Hazel being saved by Sammy, who's Leo's great-grandfather. Hazel got resurrected from the dead, and so she's from two different times. So it's not weird that she knows both Sammy and Sammy's great-granddaughter. Leo's not a girl. Great-grandson. So Hazel has a vision of being saved by Sammy from a bully, and during this time, they bond over it. Leo begins to get a crush on Hazel, but she is in love with his long-dead great-grandfather. Kinda gross, don't think about it too much. Leo and Frank have a very shaky relationship over the entire series, because Leo has fire abilities, and Frank's life actually depends on a piece of wood not being burned. His soul is actually connected to that wood. They also have a bit of a problem with each other because they both are crushing on Hazel majorly. Leo then has the biggest discovery of his life when they reach Rome. In the Pantheon, he finds an underground tunnel that leads to an Archimedes workshop. There, he has to fight demons possessing various machines around the workshop, ultimately using Nemesis's cookie to find a way to fix an Archimedes sphere and cause the two demons to kill each other. He gathers scrolls from this place, machines, blueprints, everything, because he really idolizes Archimedes. Archimedes was one of the greatest men of ancient Greece, and he is Leo's personal hero. Leo takes all this stuff, learns it, and starts applying it to his own machines, greatly enhancing them. At the end of the Mark of Athena book, Leo ends up saving Annabeth from Arachne, the spider monster. But in doing so, he blasts a hole into the floor, which Annabeth actually goes and falls into after being snared on one of the webs that is being dragged down into the hole. Percy tries to save her, but in the process is dragged down into the hole with her. Leo is really upset about himself. He thinks he just killed his two best friends, but Nico, one of the other crewmates, assures him that he didn't kill them, he just dropped them into Tartarus, which is like hell on steroids. So Leo is still not too pleased about that, but he resolves that he is going to save them and help them get out of Tartarus in the next book. However, in The House of Hades, the next book, Leo doesn't really take a huge role. I mean, he honestly doesn't do much. He has a couple of prophetic nightmares, has a run-in with trickster dwarves, and eventually frees Annabeth and Percy from Tartarus. Really, the only major important thing that happens in the House of Hades to Leo is that he, during a fight with some storm spirits, he gets blasted out of the sky and lands on Aegigia, where Calypso is being kept captive as a punishment from the gods. At first, she's really annoyed with Leo coming in and disturbing her peace, but eventually they do fall in love. Leo has to leave to continue his quest, but he does swear an oath to free her when he gets done saving the world. He doesn't do a ton in the House of Hades. He makes up for it in the Blood of Olympus. In the final battle in the Blood of Olympus, Leo flies Festus into battle against Gaia. Through a combined efforts of the seven in different places, they end up defeating Gaia, but not without Leo inevitably sacrificing himself. In the arms of the angel, fly away from here, from this dark, cold hotel room. But not really. As Festus later administers the physician's cure to resurrect him before it's too late. At the very end of the book, Leo returns to Calypso's island, navigates there, finds it, and rescues Calypso, and they literally fly off into the sunset together. Leo does appear in the Trials of Apollo, especially in the Dark Prophecy, but if we're going to be completely honest, the Trials of Apollo suck, and I personally don't consider them canon, because screw them, they're awful. Leo is a great character, much in the same way that Keith is a great character. At first he seems like a goofball, but sort of an outcast. He, like Keith, hides his pain and regret behind a mask of humor. Over time, Leo does find his family in the Seven, as the prophecy proclaimed, but he still didn't fit in. He eventually does find happiness in Calypso. A common theme throughout each of these three best characters that I like is at first, they are not what they seem at all, and over time, your perception of them changes. Leo is likable, compelling, and all in all, a great character. So to finish up the video, as I did in the last one, I'm going to say a couple quotes from Leo. Quite possibly my favorite. It sums up his character so perfectly. He says, "I try not to think. It interferes with being nuts." He's such a crazy and fun character. I love him so much. This is one of his most profound quotes in the books. "I figure the universe is basically like a machine. I don't know who made it, but it chugs along the way it's supposed to most of the time. Sure, little pieces break and stuff goes haywire once in a while, but most of the time, things happen for a reason." Another quote by him. Cool, suffering. I love suffering. Let's do this. Another quote that summarizes his character very well is, "I try very hard to be annoying. Don't insult my ability to annoy." And lastly, a quote that I think wraps up this video very well is, "Yours in demigoddishness and all that, peace out."